Hey, this is Roy Canne, and we are at the CMON Expo, and I'm here with Michael.
Yeah.
And we're going to be talking all about A Song of Ice and Fire. I heard that a bunch of new things were announced just at the panel.
Mm-hmm. We had a very exciting big panel full of, you know, just the secrets of mm-hmm. Westeros and everything revealed. But it mainly comes down to three major points that we made, which we can discuss here if you'd like.
Oh yeah, that would be awesome.
Okay, so the first thing we talked about was we did our unit updates, mm-hmm. which is the game has been out a year, we've had our tournament circuit coming out, and the biggest thing that we wanted to do was we took some units that were just underperforming or not seeing as much play, and we updated that via our app. Because one of the things is for the competitive community, we want everything to be usable at any
right.
point. And again, we noticed that there are certain things that just they weren't, you know, up to par with where we wanted them mm-hmm. to be, so we increased them as far as their effectiveness and whatnot, because if you want to play like this version of Jaime, we want you to be able to play that version of Jaime, you know, the
right.
Mountain, the Hound, some of these things that just, again, we're not
seeing as much play,
yeah.
making them better.
Exactly.
What's the main way for people to get access to all of these new updates?
So we have that via our FAQ on the website, but
okay.
we also have our War Council app, which we update with all the new releases, but this also has the updated stats in there with version control in there, and that app also contains our rule book and all those files as well, so it's your one-stop go, and you get that on Apple, Android, you know, all the major, you know.
Oh, nice. When's the update for that going live?
That actually went live immediately after the panel today.
Oh, that's awesome. So people can go right now, if they don't have the app, download it, and if they do have mm-hmm. it, they can check and make sure they get their update so they can start using the new stats for the units.
Exactly.
That's awesome.
So that was the first major talking point we had. And then we had this little announcement that we started talking about new factions, you know.
Yeah, I heard there were some rumors about some things. I have a co-host who's like super into the game. He's been playing it a ton. And he's like, oh man, Drew, this and this and this. So we're definitely excited to see some new stuff.
Well, we threw people through a little bit of a loop because, so at Gamma, we had talked about the Baratheons were our next faction.
Oh, nice.
And that is what we talked about today. So everyone had their excitement about, you know, mm-hmm. seeing Stannis and Renly and, you know, all that coming out.
Gotcha.
You know, and we showed, you know, a lot of their models, their aesthetics and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I'm sure we can splash up here and everything.
Oh, yeah.
And talk.
They definitely look pretty cool. That's one of the things is like that you get flavor from this a lot.
Mm-hmm. So the big thing for me is I will personally admit the Baratheons, like Stannis was our most requested mm-hmm. like addition to the game. Everyone loves him.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm a big book fan and
right,
everything
right.
as well. And Stannis was not my favorite character. I'll be fully honest there. Because I was like,
he did some interesting things.
He does interesting things, but he just shows up and loses every fight he's in. So like, no one's going to want to play Baratheon.
Listen, he's the underdog. Gotta fight
everyone
for the underdog.
Everyone likes the underdog, right? And that became our like our actual number one requested faction mm-hmm. above anything else that we had shown. People were like, win a Baratheons, win a Baratheons. And we figured, you know, everyone was going to be like, okay, everyone wants dragons, right? Everyone's asking for, you know, Highgarden or any of those.
I want dragons.
Everyone does. That was actually one of them. The number one question I've been asked since this game's inception was, mm-hmm. will there be dragons? And it's funny. I actually began trolling a little bit of people because I was like, oh, well, the thing is, this is based on the books. And actually, if you read the books, dragons don't exist in the books at all. And then you'd have the people that have only been watching like the show or whatnot, and they would go, oh, okay. And then you have the book fans that just go like,
That's
not true at all.
Maybe you have to walk into the fire with a copy of the game, and when you come out, no, maybe not.
Okay, so Come On Games is not endorsed in any way, walking into any fires of any of our products. They are, in fact, deeply flammable. So Dice
Tower.
So there's
other ways you might be able to find dragons.
But that segued into the last thing we talked about during mm-hmm. the presentation was we did reveal the Targaryens as well.
Gotcha.
Which they do have a strong focus on, I guess, these little things called dragons as well. They do exist in the faction. But also you have the Dothraki, mm-hmm. the Unsullied, all of Daenerys' followers and all
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
So, you know, that was our three major big reveal points there was, you know, Baratheons, Targaryens, and their unit updates as well.
So they finally made it across the Narrow Sea.
You're right. So that's the thing is like we have our distinct starting point for the game was the death of King Robert. That mm-hmm. is the last canonical event that happened. And everything after that is kind of your own unique fan fiction generator. So you
right.
just a bunch of what if scenarios. So, you know, that's the thing is like Khal Drogo is alive. And it's like, well, what if he didn't, you know, succumb to, you know, infection and die, and he and Daenerys did cross the Narrow Sea and launch this big Dothraki invasion. Now you can play that out and see exactly how that goes. You know, him versus Stannis mm-hmm. or Renly, because Renly's still alive as well, so you have him and the forces of, you know, Highgarden teaming up, Stannis with the followers of Rhaelor, Lord of Light, and all that. So it's very exciting. I mean, these two factions are some of my favorite ones from a design perspective, because right now the release of the Dothraki which is the primary like initial releases for the Targaryens. That's their starter set. It's an entirely mounted starter set faction.
All the horses.
All the horse lords. Well, not horse lords, but the great Khaleesi. The Khalasars. Mm-hmm. And then you have the Baratheons, which are split into their two semi sub factions. You're going to choose whether you want to align with Stannis or Renly. That's going to give you access to specific units and block you off from access to other ones. So Stannis, you can go and play your Railor, Lord of Light, and all that. And then Renly is teaming up more with the High Garden side of things.
Gotcha.
With, Loras and Olyanna and Margaery and all them.
That's awesome. So you just really have the theme and the flavor of the books just immersed on all these units and characters.
And that's, of course, the number one thing since, the game's inception is we want this to... Everything is dripping with theme. And, of course, everything that we do is approved through George Martin and them. So this is all, to match the vision that he has for the setting.
Right.
So we do, one of the fan favorite units we have are the Stag Knights for the Baratheons, which are these, big plated armored guys with stag antler helmets building these giant war hammers.
Yeah.
And I'll admit, they kind of won me over a little bit. Again, it's not about making what I want for the game because I'm a Bolton player. I got my guys and all that. But
you seem like a Bolton player.
Stereotypes and assumptions.
Backing away. No, I'm just kidding.
But I gotta say, the Baratheon, the aesthetic there, it's really hard to there's no way you can look at those and go I don't like those. You've got to be dead inside entirely for that to be the case.
And Come On normally does a good job with their miniatures, so definitely excited to see a lot of these on the table.
So the one thing to note about those, for anyone that's unaware, the miniatures are PVC, but any of the small or the weapons or any of the thin bits are hard plastic. So, they're better quality there, so they're not going to bend.
They're not
going to
have droopy stabs.
They're not going to have
droopy, wimpy swords falling over.
And anyone who's picked up any of the starter boxes and seen the halberdiers or any of the spearmen and whatnot, you can attest to that and see that.
That's amazing.
So we're really excited about, the future and everything coming out. This is just the tip of the iceberg. I mean, these are already really cool stuff. Mm-hmm. But man, if you guys saw just the other cool stuff, that the unknown unknowns, the things that you guys don't even know that you don't even know about.
Gotcha.
There's just so much more coming out that's just going to blow people away.
Gotcha. So if someone was had never played A Song of Ice and Fire before, what would you say is the main jumping off or starting point with this game? Should they get the star set? Can they just grab one of the new factions and play with that? What's the best way to get in on it?
So each of the factions, you're going to need the starter set to play.
Gotcha.
But the starter set's going to give you a full army to play. We have three game sizes that we recommend, small, medium, large. The starter set is going to give you enough to play a small size game with variant options in there.
Gotcha.
So it's not going to be I'm going to buy the starter set and this is going to be my one army that you have. You're going to get a couple different choices of commanders, some different non-combat characters, so you're actually going to be able to customize right out of there. So the idea is that if you, for whatever reason, picked up the starter box inside, I never want to buy another thing, you're still going to have options in there, so you're not just playing the same game over and over. But obviously buying unit boxes here, they're going to expand your armies. But we have the single player starter boxes, and if you and a friend want to get in, we have the Stark versus Lannister two player starter box, which is going to give you two full armies. And then the other factions, which we have the Night's Watch, the Free Folk, and again coming out soon now, the Baratheons and the Targaryens, there's going to give you some more options too. Get into those jumping points for those factions specifically.
Say you and all your different friends can now play a completely different house in Song of Ice and Fire.
And the thing is,
make it happen.
Even if you're playing the same faction, just by switching out different commanders, you can drastically change the different play styles that you have. So a Lannister army led by the Mountain is going to play much different than one led by Tywin or Tyrion. Again, going back to the Baratheons, you get to choose to align between Stannis and Renly. Those are different unique play
styles. And all
styles.
Those are going to mix up your deck and change the cards that you're
going
to play during the game.
Because Stannis, he is his very calculating, military commander. And Renly is going to be more charismatic.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to give you more buffs to the troops around him, where Stannis is just cold, ruthless efficiency.
Take out the enemies.
Thousands.
There you go. Awesome. Well, thanks so much for talking about A Song of Ice and Fire with us. And we're definitely excited about the new stuff. So make sure to check that out. And this has been us from CMON Expo. Thanks so much, man.